No último capítulo de A História do Futebol, acompanhamos a evolução do esporte na América do Sul e relembramos as conquistas do Uruguai nas Olimpíadas de 24 e 28 e na primeira Copa do Mundo em 1930. Vimos também como a Itália de Mussolini venceu a Copa de 34 e repetiu a dose na de 38. Por causa da guerra, a Copa seguinte seria realizada apenas em 1950, num país que transformaria o esporte em mania nacional. É desse ponto que retomamos nossa viagem pelo tempo.
O primeiro item foi justamente isso, né? Eu tirar as meias da minha mãe para fazer uma bola de meia, tá? Introduzia ali o papel, o jornal e amarrava, e dali eu começava a desenvolver os meus controles, né? Meus movimentos de controle, tudo isso. E também existia, né? A parte de participação na areia, que é muito importante, que trabalha muito a massa muscular, o teu quadríceps, etc. Dá muito jump, né? Você pá, sobe bonito.
Ancient China, via the English public schools, to the formation of FIFA in Paris. The people's game had come a long way, but there was another significant step in its journey. The birth of football in Brazil came later than in Argentina or Uruguay. The first important date from this historical text shows that the roots of the Brazilian game were put down in 1894. Charles Miller, a Brazilian born of English parents, had been at school in England, where he excelled at football and played for Southampton. He returned home to Sao Paulo with two footballs in his luggage, only to find that no one played the game. So, over the next 4 years, he preached the gospel of football. Today, Charles Miller is honored as the man who introduced football to Brazil. But in the early years, the locals were completely bemused by the game. This is a letter written by a journalist in Sao Paulo to his friend in Rio. It's dated 1896.
There, by the neighborhood of Luz and Bom Retiro, a group of English maniacs, as only they can be, put themselves once in a while to give kicks in one thing that looks like an ox's bladder, giving them great satisfaction and suffering when this kind of yellow balloon got into a rectangle formed of sticks.
The Sao Paulo Athletic Club included football into its club activities in 1895, whilst under the chairmanship of Charles Miller. The first trophy in Brazilian football was awarded for the Sao Paulo Championship and was won in the first 3 years of competition by Miller's club. The first club formed solely for the purpose of playing football was started at this Sao Paulo school. Known as Atlética Mackenzie, the club was established in 1898. 4 years later, Mackenzie played in the first ever league game in Brazil against Germania. The college still play on the same ground to this day. The brightest star of Brazilian football between 1910 and 1930 was Arthur Friedenreich. His achievement in scoring 1,329 goals in his career is still a world record in first-class football. Friedenreich is on the left, standing with his successor as the star of Brazilian football, Leonidas da Silva. His claim to fame was the invention of the bicycle kick. Leonidas was a member of the Brazilian team in the 1938 World Cup finals in France, where he scored 8 goals. However, Brazil lost in the semi-finals. But by 1950, they were ready to stage the World Cup, the competition having begun again after 6 years of war. From Rio to Sao Paulo, all the talk was of football. The Italian team, champions from 34 and 38, arrived by boat. After 12 long years since the last World Cup, the Jules Rimet trophy was to be the glittering prize. The mighty English team, entering the World Cup for the first time, arrived by plane. In Belo Horizonte, in an early game in the tournament, they faced the USA, who in football terms were comparative novices. The goal by centre-forward Larry Gations was enough to give the Americans a 1-0 win and achieve one of the biggest upsets in World Cup history. The English were not so mighty anymore. It was the Brazilians, with their brilliant striker Ademir, who were the hot favourites. 4 goals against Mexico, 7 against Sweden, 6 against Spain. They were a delight to watch. There seemed to be no stopping them. In Rio, the Brazilians had built a stadium the like of which had never been seen before. With space for 200,000 people, it's the world's largest monument to football, the Maracanã. The 1950 finals were played out on a league basis. Uruguay and Brazil came out on top and had to play off for the championship. The Brazilians only needed to draw to take the title before a world record crowd of 205,000. They'd come a long way from Charles Miller in 56 years. The Brazilians were so confident of victory, they'd had thousands of t-shirts printed proclaiming Brazil world champions. And when they took the lead in the second half, the celebrations began. But the mood changed abruptly. Schiaffino scored Uruguay's equaliser. Brazil had to hang on. There were only 11 minutes to go. Then Gigia bore down on the Brazilian goal. Against all the odds, Uruguay scored again.
Immediately after the game, almost all the Uruguayans were crying with happiness, while the Brazilians cried out of sadness. After all, the Maracanã had been built for Brazil to be champions.
A journalist who's reported on every World Cup final will never forget that day.
It was one of football's miracles. Before the final, everyone thought there was such a technical difference between the teams. It was so great that no one really imagined that Uruguay could win and take the World Cup.
I vim para o vestiário, como todos nós, fui imediatamente para casa e peguei meu automóvel, tinha um automóvel naquela época, e segui para qualquer longe, qualquer lugar. Eu fui bater em Itacuruçá, que é uma ilha aqui perto do Rio de Janeiro, e ali eu fiquei 15 dias, mas realmente me afastei de todos, depois da derrota.
Brazil's time would come. This had been Uruguay's day.